Olukeya. Emi aja ojo. Abeleya ni aja ati oso oji. Ijuro gan ibe gan o mo a kuso ni aja ati orun ni la se bi bo ba de go asi tun do awa ko je be he Atọ́sẹ̀ jẹ́ Today I'm going to talk about or continue a discussion that we've been having. And because the group today is slightly different, the composition is different from the one yesterday, I will give you a little background to what we discussed yesterday. Effectively, the two lectures are designed to be complementary. Yesterday was, if you like a technical manual. How to use a new device. When you buy your new smartphone, your computer, something radically different from what you used to, you play around with it, you know how to operate it. You learn more about its workings. So yesterday was a description of the GPS, the Global Positioning System to LAC. And today we are going to talk about how to apply it, how to make use of it. And what I mean by that is very simple. When we talk about ethics and human behavior, far too often in Western contexts, the focus is simply on issues of rules, issues of consequences. The Western approach to ethical wisdom overlooks one very important element of ethics and human behavior, which in Yoruba context is called iwakoye. And an individual who exhibits iwakoye in his or her daily activities, in his or her interaction or inactions with other living entities is someone who is called an Ọmọlúwàbí. So, this background which I will give is, I'll do this pretty quickly so that we can get to the application today. The best way to approach it is this. This GPS to life is actually the world's best kept secret. It's derived from an African tradition, which goes by various names. It goes by Orisha, and Orisha is spelled in many different ways. But the key element of it is that Orisha is actually a religious and cultural practice that is adopted by about 200 million people around the world, including many countries in Africa, Nigeria, Benin Republic, Togo, Ghana, Sierra Leone, Nigeria, Sudan, South Africa, including all the countries of the Americas, the United States, all the Latin, all the Caribbean islands, Brazil, Venezuela, Argentina, including Estonia, including Australia, and including Japan. So, if you've never heard of IFA or you've never heard of the Orisha religion, wow, you are missing out on an understanding of one of the most important things that black peoples of the world has bequeathed to humanity. And this approach to life was deemed so important by UNESCO that in the year 2005, was proclaimed one of the masterpieces of the oral and intangible heritages of humanity. And the proclamation itself was a kind of a miraculous interior spirit. The proclamation came about in the sense that someone discovered that UNESCO was designating some oral and intangible, some items, intangible items of the world as masterpieces. And the person got in touch with my dad, who is a practitioner of the religion, and it was just 1 week before the deadline to submit all applications. So within a week, I flew to Nigeria from England. We got together a couple of other professors and practitioners. We formed an organization called the Global Forum for Yoruba Religion and Culture. By the shorts, there was one filmmaker from Nollywood who was part of the group, produced a movie, wrote a dossier, submitted it to UNESCO. My dad arrived in Paris just an hour before the deadline was supposed to close. Submitted the application and Nigeria won the award. And Japan was the first government to relate to $100,000, which was matched by Nigeria. And that was used to set up place called the IFA Heritage Institute. So why is IFA so important? Now, the first thing to realize is this. The African world, the black world, is a very heavily populated world. The world that operates on principles that are radically different from those of standard westernized, Europeanized ways of looking at the world. The image you are looking at this representation of what the visual world looks like. Now, the visual world, there is really no distinction between the supernatural world and the natural world. They all form part of the same continuum. And that was precisely why I started this lecture with an invocation to the ancestors. You look around clearly, you might see them. They are here. You just need to know how to harness them. Another key feature of this worldview is that good and evil is not all there is in the world. Because there is that perfect neutrality. There are some things that are neither good nor evil. So original logic doesn't operate on the bivalent logic. There is good, there is evil, and there is neutrality. And one of the most important entities for this neutrality is an entity called Ishu, who is regarded as the universal policeman. So, the approach to ethics that this religion focuses on is one in which we need to make a distinction between four ways of thinking about ethics in general. We can think about normative ethics, the prescriptive, if you like, the normative content of your ethical principles. What ought I to do? But we can also think about meta ethics. What are the meanings of words? What does good mean? What does evil mean? What does morally right mean? Normative ethics and meta ethics are closely linked because in normative ethics you really need to unpack and explain the meaning of your ethical words. And there is also descriptive ethics. And oftentimes, what you find in so-called diverse or multi-ethnic or multi-cultural societies is that people try to operate on the basis of less and choices. So people apply some sort of descriptive ethical approach to living, in which you decide that, well, that's just your morals. You agree to decide. So you agree to, if you have a friend who believes in abortion, you don't, you agree to decide. Have someone who believes in capital punishment and someone who don't, you agree to decide. But descriptive ethics has a real fundamental problem which I'll come to later. Because implicit in descriptive ethics is a commitment to relativity, which might lead us to illogicality. Finally, there is what is called applied ethics. The main focus of applied ethics is that of how to apply the principles, rules, and values that are contained within the normative ethical system in real life situations. And that will be the focus of today's lecture. But before I go on to some of these examples, just another brief recapitulation of what we did yesterday. We talked about three different ways by which you can justify your ethical reasoning. You can focus on consequences. Something is good if and only if it produces the greatest good for the greatest number of people. Or you can adopt a deontological approach, in which something is good if and only if you follow consistently a set of principles or rules or policies that has been established in advance. But the Ọmọlúwàbí and the Wakole approach to ethics focuses on the third way. And in this third way, the essence of your character, who you are as a person, is of the most crucial importance to determining whether your actions or inactions are good or bad. Are you honest? Are you truthful? Are you someone who is proportional? Things like that are what we are going to focus on today and how to apply them. But let's start with a few examples to see how this GPS design can be adopted. One of the materials posted on the blackboard, which I would urge you to read in your own time, is something called Body Ritual Among the Nazarene. And this will perform a little bit of some kind of experiment. This was an article published by Chris Minor in 1956, in an anthropological journal published in the US. And he traveled to this region of the world where he went to study this crazy bunch of people who had various unusual views. Central to the views of this society is the idea that the human body is ugly. And from his own description, it seems as if all their life, everything is centered around making these ugly bodies they are in more beautiful. Their focus was on the beautification of the human body. And they have all sorts of rituals that were adopted to conceal characteristics of the human body. So for example, in all their homes, everyone had a shrine. There was a shrine in all homes. And in this shrine, every morning, everyone would go into the shrine one after the other individually to pay their homage to the central box, which is always in the church and the shrine. And in that central box, always all these boxes of charms. Also, this culture, they have severe sorts of weird ideas, one of which, for example, was that people bake their heads in bottles. And therefore, it was more beautiful. And there are two other ones. One is that I find it illustrative. One is the so-called holy mouth men. Once a year, or at least once a year, sometimes twice a year, everyone went to the holy mouth man. And what does the holy mouth man do? First of all, dig their teeth and put magical potions into it to make them stronger. And the one that I can't get over the most, I should have been living in that society, is the magician that was called the Leicester. This now can cure all sorts of illnesses just by this. Just by this thing to do, they can cure everything. Now, is there anyone here who finds that society, does not find that society strange? Well, go and read the article again. The Nasikima is American spelled backwards. How many of you have played your heads in the ovens? Remember all those old hair dryers? Remember that this was published in 56? Where you stick your head into it? Some of you still think, someone break your head in an oven this morning? A handheld one at least? Yeah, Nowadays, we just use the handheld ones, right? The holy mouth men, dentists. What do they do when you have a habit? First of all, they make it bigger. And they pop by to have portions in it. The listener shrinks. Go and read the article. It's quite interesting. It starts off by describing America, but not in standard geographical terms, but in terms of Native American ethnic groups that were in America and Canada. So the real point about this example is that we should pay attention to the kind of assumptions that inform our belief system. The background beliefs, the entities you believe populate your world affect what you see. In fact, they determine what you see. An anthropologist, and this has happened many times over, many anthropologists who go to various parts of the world other than the so-called Western world, look at activities and misinterpret them on the basis of their preconceived ideas and notions. But the key thing to bear in mind is this. The more limited, the more westernized, the more Europeanized your worldview is, the less likely you are to understand what it means to be a black person. The more westernized you are, the less likely you are to connect with the essence of your soul as a black person. And I'll just give you one example of that before we move on to the next application. How many of you speak languages other than English? Not everyone. That's the issue. Acquire the African language on the double. Okay? Howard has various facilities you should have. Languages are not just languages, they are monarchs into the world. If you believe that the whole world is genderized and that subjugation of women is a fact all the world over, you'll be reading and thinking too much in English. There are very many languages of the world that don't have genderized personal pronouns. There are some African languages and some Eastern languages where you might spend a whole session discussing an author, and you will never know whether the author is male or female, just from your speech. You don't use he, you don't use she, all there is male and female. So you actually need to do something extra to find out the gender of the person. Let's try another example. And we're like, Horace Miller, this is a real life lesson. In 1595, somewhere in Europe, Prophet Idiot was arrested, tried, and convicted, and executed. The child in the household had been running around the house with his one juicy piece of stick. Maybe it was a drug stick. Just killed it, and Prophet was eyeing a piece of meat, thinking, you know, am I making use of this? And probably did a lunch for the mate, beat the child's hand, and the child later died of what was described as fright. Probably was promptly arrested, sentenced, tried, and convicted. And probably was luckily for probably. Probably was not subjected to judicial torture. Everyone who was arrested for an offense in those days had to be subjected to judicial torture if you voluntarily confess, because confession was good for the soul. Probably was hung in the village square and left as an example for all dogs to see, so that he could serve as a deterrent. Is there anything wrong with the trial of poverty? How do you confess? Confession is good for the soul. The way they do it is that they find some experts who are some experts in determining the confession. So, for example, one of the types of confessions we had in those days was that you don't want to confess voluntarily, you take a piece of iron, hot piece of iron, brand it on some part of the body, lock you up in the dungeon for a few days, and the confession experts will come and study how quickly the wound festers. The quicker your wound festers and produces spores, the more guilty you are. Is there anything wrong with what happened to Mohammed? Now, one of the things that the Wagbele approach advises us to do is that if you take a good mirror at yourself before you condemn the society. If a dog were to come into this room and buy something, what's going to happen to it? You'll be put down. Hang on a second. Probably at least had a child. Probably at least had a lawyer representing him or her. Yet, we think that they were barbaric then and we are not now. The point I'm trying to drive at is that if we take out principles such as proportionality, equity, truth, honesty, things that has to do with the virtues of the person who is perpetrating an act of an action, or virtues of the enforcer, we overlook some very remarkable aspects of morality. Many people will argue, I am one of them, that in actual fact, society today was in many ways more brutal to animals than they were in 1595. At least probably God will try. So, this guy, today's meeting that I'm talking about there, is something called Ọmọlúwàbí. And what Ọmọlúwàbí is about is that it calls our attention to the fact that in negotiating our interpersonal relationships, interpersonal engagement with other individuals and other existing things, in addition to rules, in addition to consequences, we need to pay attention to the content of our actions. Are you a truthful person? Are you honest? Are you altruistic? Are you proportional? Are you interested in human flourishing? If you do not pay attention to all of those, you are not really an ethically virtuous person. You need to find a way of nurturing the ethics of your character. And what many people across the world are doing, which, if I will share three examples of this with you quickly to see how the principles contained in IFA are applied. I will give you three quick examples of them. The first book of this corpus is called a GOB. And a GOB means something like double blessing. So whenever someone wants to approach a priest or priestess of IFA for advice, if they perform the divination act or ritual, and the signature of the book that comes up is a GOB, here is a kind of poem that they are likely to recite. And here is a kind of advice that will come from it. Now, a GOB is also known as the monarch of all the IFA poems, IFA Odu. And a GOB became a monarch in this way. There are 16 of the Odu who are all siblings. The eldest of the 16 is called Ofumeji. And because the Odu are like diviners all their life, they've been practicing, helping people, giving advice to kings, giving advice to trees, giving advice to birds, in such a way that all of these individuals, they have people that are designated as the monarch, the emperor, or the king. So the 16th Odu went to Olodumare, the high god, one day. And they told Olodumare, well, we want you to tell us which among us should be the monarch of all the Odu. Ofumeji, who was the eldest, assuming that he was going to be proclaimed the elder. And Ijeobi was so drawn to all his brothers that he was leaving their errand with the one to keep the light. Ijeobi, you can't get it out. Ijeobi, you can't do this. Ijeobi, you run around to do everything for his brother. He was happy that at least his big brothers allowed him to participate. So when he got to Ujumari, the High Court, and posed their questions to Ujumari, Ujumari told them that, why do you need to have someone designated as a mother? He said, no, we want one. Ujumari told them to come back in 6 days. But before they went, Ujumari gave them a gift, just one. He gave them a mammoth offering. And when they got back to Ujumari, they divided the buffalo into 15. They forgot Ijeobi was so young, no one really taught him anything. He wasn't married, he was just a little boy. And Ijeobi was the errand boy, but he would carry the buffalo of his eldest brother of community to his home, carried everything to their each one of their respective houses. And someone suddenly realized that, oh, this young boy that's been helping us all day. What should you give to him? We forgot about him. Someone said, why don't you give him the head? Are you going to give the head of the buffalo? Give him the head. So they gave Ijeobi the head. And when they got back to Ọmọlúwàbí's abode on the 16th day, Ọmọlúwàbí asked them how he divided the buffalo to give to them. And Ọmọlúwàbí said, so they said, well, Ọmọlúwàbí took a tie, or Ọmọlúwàbí took the breast part, someone took this. And Ọmọlúwàbí said, okay, who took the head? Oh, no one wanted the head, he gave it to Ijeobi. And Ijeobi was proclaimed the head. Now, the moral of that is, first of all, take your duty seriously, even when it seems as if you're bossing you around. Because in the act of being bossed around, you are actually learning new things that can enrich your character. Secondly, it also advises that if you are in a position of authority, a position of leadership, leadership and authority is fragile. It will be removed. It might become subservient to someone you are learning about in the future. So pay good attention to how you treat people who are below you, because of the way down, they might be on the top. That's an example of how the questions in duty are used as guides to the behavior. Another example is about someone called Mr. By Force and the spoiling of the earth. Mr. By Force, in those days, Yoruba societies, when people want to build houses, they call their friends. But Mr. Byforce was such a cantankerous person that there were just a handful of people who would call his friends. So he went around to his friends. The first friend he went to was a grasshopper. He said, Mr. Grasshopper, I want to thatch my roof by Friday and I want to start working on this house. Can you come and help me? Grasshopper says, Mr. Captain Byforce, I know you don't have too many friends. I'll come and help you. After the grasshopper, he went to the hen. The hen had been to come as well. After the hen, he went to the hyena. After the hyena, he went and called the hunter. After the hunter, he called the snake. After the snake, he called the walking stick. After walking stick, he called fire. After fire, he called dewdrops. He called rain, and then he called dewdrops. But because we start by first life to do everything by he forgot to provide food for his friends. So around lunchtime, the grasshopper stretched and said, Mr. Byforce, what are you going to eat? The hen had food, boom, picked up the grasshopper. Hyena had food, picked up the hen. The hunter had food, shifted the car, shot the hyena. Snake had food, beat the hunter. Walking stick, smash on the stick. Fire consumed the walking stick. And dew drops eventually came and really agree with all of them, and they all know that. Now, the advice of people here is that if you are in a cooperative, engaging in cooperative enterprise, first of all, pay close attention to the kind of people you will invite to come and help you. And second, don't be opportunistic. Don't wait until you need people's help before you start approaching them. There is a proverb in Yoruba that advises that only those who pour water on the ground ahead of them walk on the whole ground. If you wait until the last minute before you start being nice and acting as if you are concerned, you will end up with a bad type of people to help you. Pay attention to how you deal with people, even when you don't need them for anything. Because in the long run, you might require assistance. So those are two points from the Family Tribe Purpose, and they give us a kind of clear-cut advice on why character is important. The essence of you, who you are. You are connected, therefore, in my own view. It's really about what you can call well-being freedom. It's about tangible freedom. It's not just about freedom that is enshrined in a book somewhere that some aged, white old, mostly white old men interpret and call the Constitution. Iwakwele is about how we inculcate virtues into the essence of our being, such that we make use of these virtues as the global positioning system for daily living. Wapene, therefore, is not something that's externalized. It's not something that's just enshrined in the Constitution. It's internalized. You need to learn more about these principles, what they mean, and inculcate them into your nature such that you act on their basis instinctively. For us, that really means that any living thing deserves some level of respect. Pay attention to the kind of capacities and limitations that each individual has, and your own capacities and limitations, and to relate to them in such a way that you don't just treat them as ends, you don't just treat them as means, you also pay attention to the values that inform your belief system. So I'll round up with two quick things. One is a warning. Philosophy is a very dangerous activity. And as much as I like philosophy, I should also warn you about its dangers. If you take philosophy seriously, you might end up not playing too much niceties with many of your friends, because oftentimes, what we do when we agree to disagree is to sweep the essence of an issue under the carpet. But imagine that you have a friend who believes that theft is right, and you believe that theft is not right. If your friend genuinely believes that theft is right, and someone steals your friend's iPhone or computer or something else, that friend should not complain. Because if you really believe that theft is right, then you should be willing to accept the fact that it's okay for someone to steal something that belongs to you. And that's exactly the kind of logical problems you get yourself into if you adopt a position that with all difficult issues, the only solution is just to agree to disagree. Agree to disagree is just not solving the problem. So I'll end up so that we'll have some time for questions by putting all of this into a kind of pictorial representation. Really, we are talking about social justice. Social justice is about the distribution of benefits and burdens in situations where there is scarcity. And standardly, the usual way in which people think about it is to think in terms of several concepts of justice, where we think about rights, or desires, what people desire on the basis of what they've done, that what you need focusing on what they lack. Rights are really conservative in the sense that rights are the most toothless of all the principles of social justice. Any right you have simply because someone has decided to grant it to you. And that means they can take it away. All the rights that we like to popularize and emphasize in America are contained in the constitution that were written by someone. And that effectively means it's not something you owe. And really, that means that there are no truly you don't have any inalienable rights. Because all that means is that some people have decided, some countries have decided to come up with certain treaties and agree that they are going to accord all human beings with a particular type of right. Rights is conservative, it depends upon someone granting it to you. The Wapele approach focuses on just one single concept, good character, and look at your virtues. So I will end up with just another quick chapter. Here, hoping that you pay attention to everything you do as a human being. Pay attention to your character. But as I said a few minutes ago, philosophy comes with a warning. If you take your character seriously, one consequence of that is that you have a right to be punished. What that means is that if you take your character seriously, if you violate or commit an infraction, you will be the first person to put yourself on the punishment. If I don't know, Marika, I say, oh, or oh, maybe oh, oh. If I don't know, oh, no, 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 no,